Yes, so I will. I'll talk about. Thanks for inviting me. Thanks for the opportunity to give this talk and the introduction. So I will talk about the Citizens Commission of Election, which brought out its report earlier part of this year in 2021, and it brought out several reports, but I'll restrict in this talk only to electronic voting. So the Citizen Commissions of Election was formed just before the pandemic started, around January, February of 2020. And the key person as whose behest the Citizens Commission was formed was Mr. M.G. Devasaham. And I can see that he's listening in. Thank you, sir. I think that the commission did work for about over 1.5 years with over more than 100 Zoom calls, went through volumes of depositions, did lots of research, and were helped by a whole lot of other people. It was headed by Justice Madan Lokur. It also had the advantage of having two constitutional judges in the commission who kept us in check. The volume one dealt with the compliance and EVM and VVPAT with democracy principles. The reason this was brought out was the unrest in the country with the speculations about possibilities of hacking and so on and so forth. The second part, which dealt with many more topics, it dealt with electoral rolls. That study was done by Mr. V. Ramani and Harsh Mandar with a little addendum by me. Money, power, and criminalization was mostly researched by Anjali Bharadwaj. Model code of conduct by Jagdeep Chokar and others. Role of media by Paranjay Ghotakurta. Role of ECI by Professor Sanjay Kumar. It also dealt with many other topics like linking Aadhaar with the voters list, disenfranchisement, and so on and so forth. The two volumes is going to come out as a book edited by Mr. Devasaham and published by Paranjay Ghotakurta in the early part of the next year. So I'll essentially talk about volume one of this report. So the volume one was essentially based on depositions and depositions by these ladies and gentlemen. I think that the last series of depositions in which Ron Rivest, whose name was mentioned several times, and so this was based on depositions by these ladies and gentlemen, very large number of high quality depositions, and the computer science lot by Purvi Vora. I mean, this was a joint deposition. Purvi collected all of them from people who have worked in elections for now 30 years, like Ron Rivest and Philip Bistark. And they were surprisingly aware of the Indian elections, and all of them deposed, and they were very, very valuable. And let me try to, give out our findings. So first is why electronic voting? And I think Shivam brought out this topic. In computer science, as Subodh mentioned, computer science has looked at electronic elections for 40 years, and there are great protocols over many, many years. Traditionally, in computer science, it's only because of correctness. It's never because of efficiency. In fact, electronic elections are not that efficient. But somehow in the Indian discourse, these two have got a little confused. Right? So sometimes we talk about efficiency, sometimes we talk about correctness, and sometimes we mistake that. So the democracy principles, I mean, this is essentially a simplification of the Representation of the People's Act. If you read the Representation of the People's Act and the main wish list out of the Representation of the People's Act, if you summarize in plain English and cut out the legalese, then this is what it will look like, right? So it should be transparent. The general public should be satisfied about that their voter recorded correctly. The voting process ought to be publicly auditable. Ordinary citizens should be able to check the essential steps, right? That's a crucial thing. So no zero knowledge proofs, as was already mentioned out there. The election process should not only be free and fair, but should also be seen to be fair. Right? It should create public trust, and otherwise the whole purpose of electoral democracy gets defeated. The election commission should be in full control of the entire voting process. it should not be that they have, the certain parts of the election is being conducted by methods and means which they are not aware of or not directly in control with. And electronic processes, that if they're to be used for voting at all, this was not a part of the Representation of the People's Act, but this is a conventional wisdom all around the world. They should be in sync with changing technologies and practices and be amenable to public audit and scrutiny. Right? So that's a desiderata. And when you come to electronic verifiability, the public verifiability essentially comes from two parts. Right? There's an administrative verifiability. And administrative verifiability essentially is what ECI has largely put his efforts on, which is certification of equipment. There's an elaborate process by which equipment is certified. There's a trustworthiness of custody chain of election, pre and post election. There are strong rooms, there are seals of various kind, there are locking of EVMs, putting them in trunks, moving them around by tracking with GPS. There are a variety of methods. They are well listed in the ECI webpage, which they do. The trustworthiness of the custody chain of VVPAT slips. So this is essentially based on seals and strong room. So there's an assumption that the VVPATs, even if they're trustworthy right at the election, they remain trustworthy at the time of counting, which is some are not destroyed or new ones are not added. And these are standard conventional administrative processes that take care of it. And VVPATs are supposed to audit electronic elections. So this is a simple scheme that that we practice in India. The public verifiability part is largely missing, right? I mean, which is Subodh talked about at great length that what computer science has endeavors to give methods so that the public can directly verify that their votes are cast as intended, recorded as cast, and counted as recorded. So this part is largely missing and omitted in Indian elections. So what we found is that since these crucial steps are missing, so we've got computer science into public life, but left its rigor behind. And that has created a little bit of a problem. There is a general public mistrust about the whole process. And I think Shivam mentioned that he hasn't seen whether there's any evidence, direct evidence of tampering. No, even the commission did not get any direct evidence of tampering. But the commission did get lots of report about indirect evidence of tampering. The commission received depositions, which means 2 lakh EVMs went missing. PCI had no control of them. Or EVMs landed up in the car dicky of the car of a candidate. So which means that many of the administrative verifiability processes have been violated. Now, whether that has influenced the election, it's not clear, right? Some political parties say yes, some political parties say no. But this mistrust is not good for democracy. What are the easy ways to remove this mistrust? That's what we will try to explore a little bit. There is this recent talk about internet voting, quite a bit, right? And this is almost impossible, as Subodh mentioned. I just quietly believed in computer science. Computer science has known this for a very, very long time, that internet voting are a strict no-no. And I think there is a complete agreement with it. So in the computer science community, so that this is being talked about in the national scale in India is a little surprising. And this, as Subodh has already mentioned, but let me touch upon, this is because of 2 essential problems. What is the secure platform problem? So you may own a cell phone or an app, but for a general voter, for even the expert voter, like a computer scientist like Subodh, there is no way for him to know that his machine is not hacked or tampered, right? So that his machine or his cell phone will follow his instruction correctly and vote as he wanted, there is no way to guarantee that. Right? That's called the secure platform problem. Now, right now, computer science cannot solve that. There's no way to give a guarantee that your cell phone will not get hacked. One cell phone maybe yes, but a public collection of cell phones will not get hacked. There's no such technique in computer science. Whether such techniques will evolve in the next 20, 30 years, we hope it will, but we are unsure. But the second problem will never get solved, how to make it coercion-free. right? As long as the possibility, I think Subodh tried to mention this, that as long as the possibility of the wife coercing the husband to vote for her favorite political party, internet voting is not possible, right? So if they don't come to the polling booth and vote from their bedroom, there's no way of knowing who is coercing who. And that problem, no technology or social process can even solve. So that makes internet voting a strict no-no. It's an impossibility. And this has been realized for a very, very long time. It's not new. You know, for 15 years, this has been documented that internet voting is an impossibility. And the US National Academy of Sciences, Engineering and Medicine jointly in 2018 recommended that elections can be only conducted using polling booths, and that too using human readable paper ballots, not using complicated electronic or cryptographic technology. And this is a 200 member committee that made this recommendation very recently in 2018. And they were quite emphatic. The report is available online, and it's a quite an emphatic report out there. And this roughly followed the recommendation of the German Constitutional Court, which came out in 2009 with a recommendation which almost banned electronic voting in Germany. So though this is not the German Constitutional Court's ruling is not applicable in other jurisdictions like United States, England, Ireland, France, and so on and so forth. But most countries have honored this judgment, and I'll explain why. So most countries have abided by this judgment and have moved away from electronic voting completely. So let's now look at only an EVM-only solution. Let's try to see that why the German Constitutional Court gave this ruling. And let's talk about an EVM-only solution where you assume for the time being there is no VVPR, no VVPAT associated with the process. So votes are recorded electronically by press of a button, and it gets recorded somewhere inside electronically. And there's no way for the voter to know what has been recorded. So I pressed 1 and the machine recorded 2. And it tells me that I've recorded 1, there's no way for a voter to verify what has got recorded. Right? And this is this violates almost all principles of voting. So there is no way for a voter to provide a guarantee to a voter that the vote is cast as intended. There's no way to resolve a dispute either, right? If the voter says that, look, my vote was not recorded correctly, there is no way the election authority can convince the voter that is not the case, because it has just gone inside and incremented some counter by 1, and you only have an aggregate vote, so you have lost all ways to resolve a dispute. And as Subodh mentioned, not having dispute resolution is not good for voter confidence. So that's a typical problem. And also, there is no way to establish that a system as complicated as an EVM is correct. It is known to be a theoretically a very hard problem, almost an impossible problem. And this was proved mathematically by Rebecca Mercier in 1992, that the correctness is impossible to prove. Note, I must also add that the incorrectness is also impossible to prove. Right? That the machine is incorrect is also impossible. So in general, to make a statement that this machine will always function correctly, you know, statements of the type that ECI is routinely making every day in national press, there is a theorem to say that such statements have no meaning, right? And the theorem is due to Mercury. So she's the one who recommended VVPATs in 1992. So she said that one easy way to solve this problem, if done correctly, is to have a voter verified paper audit trail, and which has become routine in most elections all over the world. And it is in general, hence it is impossible to predict whether a machine like this can ever reach a state that will violate democracy principles. Right. So the machine can potentially, as complicated as an EVM, can potentially lie in a very, very large number of states. And it's impossible to examine all of them to figure out that whether one of them is a hacked state or not. Right? So that's not possible. So it is impossible to say whether an EVM can be hacked or not. That an EVM has not been hacked is no guarantee that it cannot be. If it is hacked, it is hacked. But till it is hacked, nobody can make any statement about the hackability of it. Testing of a system such as an EVM can never constitute a problem. You can only test a finite kind of behaviors. You can test for functioning, but you can never test for correctness. You can say that the most common use cases, the machine is behaving correctly. But you can never test for the infinitely many uncommon use cases that can show up. So in computer science, we have got a maxim that testing never constitutes a proof. So you can never certify your machine to be correct by testing. That's not possible. And theoretically, one can never test for all possibilities. So in particular, a hacked system can easily be made to behave correctly under test conditions. So that's not a problem at all. And I think that many people in the depositions have pointed this out. At least 6 or 7 depositions have pointed this out. So these issues like these claims that one-time programmability, quality assurance testing, we have done all this and hence we are correct, they don't pass muster. They are statements of dubious quality. And none of cast as intended, recorded as cast, and counted as recorded are possible. And it is the onus should be on the ECI to demonstrate correctness, not on others to show that it can be hacked. So this public challenge like come and hack, they are, the little bit of a circus. They don't make any sense really. And I think that the Citizens Commission of Report has come down very strongly on such practices. Elections Committee's job is not to throw hackathon, but to convince the public at large that the system and the process that they have designed with or without electronics is correct. So the ruling of the German Constitutional Court says this. I think the main point is that because an EVM is a black box, and there's no way to know what is going on inside. So the use of voting machines which electronically record a voter's vote and ascertain the election results meet constitutional guarantees only if the essential steps of voting and the ascertainment of result can be examined reliably without any specialist knowledge of the subject. So German Constitutional Court is quite clear that computer scientists like Subodh and or the Election Commission's technical expert committee have no locus standi. They should not be trusted. They are untrustworthy. And just on their certification, an election cannot be declared correct. Nobody in a public election has a right to claim expertise to declare an election correct. So this has to be verifiably correct and without any specialist knowledge. So an expert has no role in a conduct of an election. And this was a very, very compelling judgment. And most of the world has abided by it, but not so in India. And that's a concern a little bit. The Constitutional Court also said that the legislature is not prevented from using electronic voting machine if the possibility of reliable examination of correctness, which is constitutionally prescribed, is safeguarded. So it suggested that you may use a complementary examination system, perhaps through a VVPAT, where votes are recorded in another way beyond electronics, beside electronic storage. In India, Mr. Subramaniam Swamy, bought this German for filed a public interest litigation in the Supreme Court and relying mostly on this German Constitutional Court's judgment. And he got a favorable ruling from the Supreme Court as a result of which Election Commission of India was asked to introduce VVPAT and not use EVM only solutions. So since 2011, 2012, thereabouts, we are using VVPATs in our elections, and mostly because of this ruling by the German Constitutional Court. So we need baby pads, right? And this was recommended by Mercury way back in 1992. She almost thought in her PhD thesis that without baby pad, there is no real way to do an election. Must say that she had foresight. So what is the conventional wisdom? The conventional wisdom is that there is a definite need to move away from certifying voting equipment, from a certification process, to establishing that the outcome is correct. Even if you are using wrong machines, even if you are using uncertified machines, it does not matter. As long as you can show that there is no, you know, that your outcome has no problem. And this is the way to conduct trustworthy elections. And I think the German Supreme Court made this observation. The US National Science Academy made this observation. And Rebecca Mercuri made this observation way back in 1992, that you can never conduct an election correctly by certifying voting. Right? That's a strict no-no. Instead, concentrate on establishing that your election are correct independent of the voting equipment. Right? There are two ways to do this. The first way has been examined in computer science for now 40 years, which is end-to-end verifiable cryptographically secure voting protocol. Right? These are, many of them are extremely sound. Some Subodh has presented. We believe we have one from IIT Delhi, which is completely correct, takes care of everything. But they are difficult to deploy in public life because of they're good to publish papers with, get academic brownie points. But deploying them in public and throwing them at the public at large is a little bit of a problematic issue. Because of the ruling of the German Constitutional Court, it will require experts to certify correctness, mathematicians to certify correctness. And why an electorate should trust mathematics is not clear. In fact, clear that they should not trust mathematics. So worldwide cryptographic voting systems are not popular. It's not because they're incorrect, but it is because that generating trust in them requires certification by experts. But ECI should still obviously explore the possibilities. I believe that if not today, tomorrow, this is the route to doing elections correctly, because you can give mathematical guarantees that elections can be conducted correctly, completely correctly, without any risk whatsoever. The second way to do this, if the first is not a possibility, and it appears to be not a possibility today, is to do post-election risk-limiting audits using VVPATs. Yet you have got a VVPAT system that you have recorded votes using VVPATs. Use those VVPATs to do a risk-limiting audit. How to do this is completely worked out in this great paper called Evidence-Based Election by Stark and Wigner. Stark submitted a deposition to the Citizens Commission of Election as well. He's a professor of statistics at Berkeley. And he gave this elaborate statistical procedure about how to do the audit. And we will discuss some of that. So what are the essential requirements? And essential requirements are then software independence, as Subodh touched upon. And this essentially means that if there is an undetected change in software or hardware, that should not cause an undetectable change in the election outcome. So even if the machine malfunctions, it should be possible to detect that the malfunctioning has happened. That's called software independence. This does not mean that you cannot use software or hardware, but a malfunction in the software should not become undetectable. Right? So that's what we call software independence in computer science. And the second property is dispute resolution. That is clear that anybody challenges, like Subodh challenges that my vote was not recorded correctly, that must result in either the challenger or the election authority being proved wrong. So there has to be a clear determination about it one way or the other. Right? Now, if there is no dispute resolution, there's no voter confidence in the process. Now, dispute resolution cannot be done in a direct electronic recording machine. Between a man in a secret transaction between a man and a machine, there is no way of determining who is lying. If I press 1 and the machine said you press 2, now that's an event that has happened without any witness, and it's obvious common sense that there's no way to conclusively determine who is right, who is wrong. Between two human beings in private also, there is no way, but there are traditional methods like fist fights and so on and so forth, but you can't even fight with a machine. So the only solution is then be fair to the voter. you cannot possibly be fair to a machine. That doesn't make sense. So if you cannot do dispute resolution in electronic machine, then as many of our people who have deposed to the commission have said, that the only sensible solution is to be fair to the voter. So what are the VVPAT requirements? This is required by law in most jurisdictions, including in India. If you conduct electronic elections, then VVPAT are a must. But the Indian VVPAT system, we in our examination, we found that has some lacunae. There is no clear definition in about which is the vote. Right? So the representation of the People's Act talked about the ballot paper as it. The EVM somehow has not even made a proper appearance in the representation of the People's Act. So there's a big problem. And now if you're running two parallel elections, one with voter verified paper audit trail, and one is the electronic vote, then which is the vote? Because they are not in one-to-one correspondence, or they're not demonstratively in one-to-one correspondence. In which case, which is the one that should be counted? And that's a lacunae that is there in the Indian election system. Indian election system, the representation of the people act says that the paper one should be the vote. But India seems to be counting the electronic one. Right? And that is both a theoretical, political, constitutional anomaly. Second is the voter should have a full agency to cancel a vote, cast vote if not satisfied. Right? And this process should be simple. And should not require the voter to interact with anybody. But the Indian VVPAT system is not truly voter verified. It's not truly voter verified because of the following reason, that if you press a button, so suppose you vote for a political party A, and suppose the VVPAT slip prints political party B, there's no way for the voter to cancel the vote. Because the voter verified paper audit slip does not come to the voter's hand. There is no physical process of casting the vote. So it gets displayed behind a glass window for 7 seconds and then gets detached and falls in a sack and becomes indistinguishable. So if that point the voter raises a dispute that, look, I pressed my preference for political party A and the VVPAT slip printed political party B, then there is no way to resolve that dispute. And there is Indian election system, there is an incredible report of such disputes. And there's also a 5,000 rupees fine if the voter cannot prove that she's being truthful. Now that is a travesty of justice, right? And as a result, in our depositions, we heard a story that even a police officer, a retired police officer, claims that he's scared to dispute. How will I ever prove that that I'm right? Now look, that if the polling officer comes in and does a mock poll next time, that the mock poll happened correct does not mean that the previous complaint was incorrect, right? That's incorrect logic. So the voter verified paper audit trail is not truly voter verified. So this needs to be corrected. And the only way this needs to be corrected, can be corrected, is the voter verified paper audit trail is something that comes to the voter's hand, the voter checks it, and to complete the voting process manually puts it in the box, right? That's the notion of a casting, in which case the paper should be the true vote, the correct vote. The electronic one is only a proxy. And this needs to be correctly reflected and in an amendment in the Representation of People's Act. And this is a recommendation. This is one of the recommendations of the commission, that this is too much of a undefined status. This does not make sense. This needs to be immediately corrected in future elections. Now the VVPAT requirements are, the VVPAT may be trustworthy during voting. Suppose it comes to the voter's hand and the voter puts it in the box, then it's definitely trustworthy during the voting. It captures the voter's instinct. But how do you know that they remain trustworthy during audit? You know, there's an intervening period in the last parliamentary constitutional election. You know, there were 3 months or 2 months gap between voting and counting. And this requires compliance audits. And, you know, to Stark and Wagner, it is an elaborate process by which this compliance audit can happen to ensure that there are trustworthiness, there are statistical processes, which I will not describe out here. The next question about which there are about, I believe there are some 20 or 30 cases pending right now in Supreme Court of India, which is how many EVMs should be audited? An EVM captures about 2,000 votes. A polling booth is about of 2,000 votes. So assembly constituency typically has about 300 EVMs. A parliamentary constituency about 10,000 EVMs. So how many of those EVMs should be audited with full manual paper counting? And this is a dispute. And suppose, what should be done if an EVM count does not match the VVPAT count? Declare the election for the entire population null and void and do a re-election? Or discard the electronic votes and do a paper count for the entire constituency? Now, these are not adequately defined in the Election Commissions of India's procedure. And this is a big problem. They say audit, fine, audit. But if the audit fails, so if you find that by electronic count, party A has won, but by manual VVPAT count, party B has won in a polling booth, right? Then what can you conclude about the entire constituency? And what should you do? Now, you know that the electronic count is not matching the paper count. Now, which should you trust? Paper? Electronics? Right now, the answer is electronics. And this is a hugely problematic situation because of reasons that I'll try to. But anyway, this first is that this process is not defined completely. So this requires making amendments in the Representation of People's Act and making this completely clear what should be done in case of a mismatch. Okay, so the risk limiting audit process goes. The other thing I want to mention out here is that we requested the ex-election commissioners to depose, the last 10 chief election commissioners to depose to a committee. Only one of them did, Mr. Hureshan. We also asked the technical committee of the Election Commission of India to depose before the commission. We got no reply. But from private conversations, we heard that the reason that the VVPAT slips cannot be counted is that it takes too much time. Right. And almost all the people that we talked to, like Shivam Shankar Singh, who made a presentation, thought that time should not be an issue. You are electing your representative, your prime minister, who will rule you for the next 5 years. And how does two more days matter to count all VVPAT slips? And also, there are technologies to count VVPAT slips. There are note counting machines in the banks. You know, IIT Delhi can design a mechanical VVPAT slip counting machine, which can just count 2,000 VVPAT slips in a matter of 1 second. You know, it'll go and count. So, you know, if note counting machines can be designed, why can't VVPAT counting machines not be designed? And if you count by a mechanical process, standalone process, and if that tallies with the electronic process, you know things are all right. So not counting the VVPAT slips, there is the commission found no convincing reason that why the entire set of VVPAT slips should not be counted. It appeared to the commission that's an easy thing to do. It should not even take too much time. Even if done manually, and there is no need to do it manually, there are note counting machines that you can go to every bank. Such a thing can be designed. And there are many, many companies and educational institutions and IITs in India that can effortlessly design such a counting machine, so mechanical counting machine. So again, the response that this will make it inefficient does not pass muster. But if you want to do a statistical sampling only and not count the entire EVM, I think that you should count all the VVPATs, but if you don't want to count all VVPATs, then this question assumes that how many VVPATs how many EVMs should be audited by full VVPAT counting? And the answer in statistics comes from this distribution called a hypergeometric distribution. So you don't have to understand it, but this essentially tells you, defines the probability of finding K defective item in NRAW in a population of capital N, which may have capital K defective objects. So if you know that there are 1% faulty television sets, right? 1% television sets are faulty. Then how many should you sample in a population of 1,000? How many television sets should you examine closely to determine, say, 5 faulty sets? Right? This is given by the hypergeometric distribution. This is routine in engineering. This is taught to second year students in statistics. And every component, engineering component, is audited. You cannot probably test every possible car that you are manufacturing. You select a small sample based on a statistical sample given by the hypergeometric distribution, put them to rigorous test. If they pass the test, you declare that the whole lot is correct statistically with a very high probability, right? This is the way you sell televisions. This is the way you sell cars. This is the way you sell cell phones and computers. No company has the wherewithal to test every iPhone that they have manufactured. That's not possible. It comes out of the factory with a standard process. You check a small statistical sample and declare the whole lot correct with a high confidence. Now, if you do that process, this is from an IAS officer called Ashok Bharadhan Shetty. He didn't depose to our commission, but he wrote an article in the Hindu Business Line before the commission came out, and the commission took Suomoto cognizance of his article. And his statistics were impeccable, and it matched Professor Philip Stark's recommendation exactly. Right? They gave exactly the same process. And what it says is that suppose 1% EVMs are faulty or hacked or whatever, right? To detect at least one faulty EVM with 99% probability, how many EVMs should you sample? So it so turns out that if your population is, how many zeros? This is 1 crore. Of course, there's 7 zeros. I can't even read. So if you take, but it does not matter. If it is 1 crore, and if it is 1% faulty EVM, sampling 459 EVMs, you will get one faulty EVM with 99% certainty, right? And if you add one more zero, the number doesn't change. It remains 459. For 1 lakh EVM, it is 458. You have to sample only one less EVM, right? So the Election Commission of India went to the Supreme Court and said that one per assembly constituency is enough. And they were backed by some top-class statistician from India of very high repute who filed affidavits in the Supreme Court in support of ECI's claim. And they presumably went by this plot. And they said that if you take a parliamentary constituency, or if you take the whole country as a whole with 1.2 billion population, that's somewhere out there, or if you deploy so many EVMs, then collecting only about 400 EVMs is statistically auditing only about 400 EVMs is sufficient for the entire population. Right? But the problem is that what should be the population? An assembly constituency has about 30 to 300 EVMs. A parliamentary constituency has about 300 to 18,000 EVMs. A state as a whole, you know, depending on how large the state is about 10,000 EVMs. And India as a whole has about 10 lakh EVMs, right? In a parliamentary election, India as a whole deploys 10 lakh EVMs. So if you consider the entire India as a population and say that auditing 459 EVMs are sufficient, you are assuming a homogeneity across the entire country. You're assuming that your election subversion strategy in Kerala is exactly the same as the election subversion strategy in West Bengal, and is exactly the same as the election subversion strategy in Kashmir, right? But election results are declared in much smaller units. So if you go to a one assembly constituency and say that there are only 300 EVMs there, then you're in this zone. Then the curve shows that you will require to audit about 50% EVMs. If you are in a larger parliamentary constituency which has got about 1,000 EVMs, then you have to, for the same certainty, you have to do about 40% EVM, 36.8% EVM needs to be statistically audited. So this claim that you need to, so ultimately the Supreme Court ruled that neither this way and not that way, audit only 5 EVMs per assembly constituency, and that's the current practice. Now that has no statistical or logical basis. And what shows is an assembly constituency is typically of 1,000 EVM, then this detection should require at least 368 EVMs to be audited. Right? If you want to manually count, if you don't want to do a full VVPAT count, but only do a statistical count, then you have to pick up 368 EVMs from this and do a count. So, and this is elementary. Any second year engineering student should tell you, and Supreme Court should have used better judgment than to come up with a dictum and say that 5 EVMs per assembly constituency is sufficient. That doesn't seem to have any statistical basis. And in fact, as another deposition, this is probably by Professor Stark, he drew this table to show that if misreporting EVMs in a Lok Sabha constituency at 25%, then the Supreme Court's dictum will capture it with a virtual certainty. But if the misreporting EVM in a Lok Sabha constituency is only 1%, then you will detect it with only a probability 1/3, and you will miss it with the probability 2/3. Now, that is not good statistics from Supreme Court of India. And this is something that the commission very strongly objected to. So I think that blockchains. Let me see if I have the time for blockchains. Perhaps not. I think that Subodh has talked about blockchains already. I will just mention by saying that blockchain is a thing that the commission also investigated, and the commission's report we have published in an India Forum article. And there is adequate, the conventional wisdom in computer science says that a blockchain-based election does not make any sense. A blockchain is a process that goes with distributed consensus. And when there is only one authority, that notion of a distributed consensus does not arise. So the US Academy of Sciences report has also cautioned against blockchain, saying that it's a hype that should be completely ignored, and this can have disastrous consequences for elections. The Citizens Commission of Election also makes the same recommendation. And I will not discuss this in great detail out there. So in a summary, it is well known that it is impossible to verify an electronic system as complicated as an EVM. So VVPATs are a must. If you use a VVPAT, then define which is the vote. The VVPAT is the vote, or the electronic button press is the vote correctly. And what should you do if they don't mismatch? Right? Leaving that undefined is not good for democracy. The VVPAT system should be voter verified. Not having the VVPAT system, it's called voter verified paper audit trail. So not having it voter verified is a fundamental flaw. EVM audit by cross-checking with manual VVPAT, the commission did not understand that why 100% VVPAT counting cannot be done. It seemed easy. But if you have to do a statistical audit, follow well-established statistical procedures. Don't arbitrarily declare 5 EVM should be audited per constituency. And blockchain really does not address the verifiability problem, either for electoral processes or for polling. Yes, so I'll stop here. And if there are questions, I'll try to take.
Thank you. Thank you, Professor. Very enlightening, very clear presentation on the difficulties in designing these systems. And what you said, about machine readability of the VVPATs, etc., makes perfect sense. Why should it not be possible? So one question that comes to mind is that, you know, why the EVM should not record the vote rather than keep a count of the votes? It can electronically, digitally record the votes in a random order in a stack. And the automatic reading of the VVPAT should be part of the transport of the slip itself into the vault. So as you see it going in, it should be read by the device, tallied against the vote which is digitally recorded, and then allowed to drop into the vault. This way, you will get votes in the vault that exactly match the recorded votes, and you can recount both anytime you wish. Of course, you will not have one-to-one correspondence between the slip and the electronic version. Can we do something like that?
There are two problems. You know, one is that just the VVPAT matches the EVM does not give you a guarantee that the election has gone correctly, right? They just show that they both match. Yes. Why can't I delete 5 votes from both or add 5 votes into both, right? In favor of my political party. That's one. The second thing is that the reason the Indian EVM does not record identical votes, but just records an aggregate cumulative count, is because nobody can guarantee that the EVM will maintain secrecy. Right? And the EVM leaking vote information is something that probably a risk that the ECI designers did not want to take. But then the system that we have proposed, you know, the cryptographic system, the EVM keeps a full record. But EVM keeps a completely encrypted record. In fact, you know, it is in computer science, almost all designs except 2 or 3 keeps the vote secret from the EVM. EVM getting to know the vote is an extremely problematic thing. You know, so I like Shivam Shankar Singh made a statement that an EVM is reasonably safe if it is not connected. There can be no electronic equipment that is not connected. You are interacting with the environment through heat, through sound, through light. So there are hundreds of channels, and it's impossible to know that the electronic equipment is not shouting out in an unaudible band that Subodh has just voted for BJP, you know, for example, right? And this can be communicated out. You don't need an internet for this. You can do it in the infrared band or the ultrasound band, or you know. So, and I can hide an antenna in an electronic device that you cannot recognize even if you open it.
There is that famous case of a radiating antenna, which is not even electrically transmitted.
So I think that this is a false conception that a machine is not connected. A machine, if it is not connected, it does not exist. Like a human being is connected to other human beings, right? I mean, otherwise, your machine is not breathing. So machine getting to know the vote is a very big risk. This risk is mitigated in Indian election by machine just keeping a count. But if the machine maintains a record, which is in one-to-one corresponding with the VVPAT, then the risk increases manifold, right? I think that the electronic, if you want to go that route, if you want to take that route, then you have to keep the vote secret from the EVM.
Yes.
And the best election is conducted if the EVM is a public machine. You take public laptop. In USA, elections are conducted using public laptops. You take them from schools and conduct an election. That's where there's the least chance of hacking. So you don't require the correctness of the machine to conduct an election correctly. You should be able to conduct on the polling officer's cell phone and using just an app. And those will be the perfectly correct election. So this, and that's what computer science has been advocating for a very long time. Somehow the Indian election system has not gone in that direction.
Thank you. Thanks. There is one interesting question from Mr. Barua, a comment rather, that you know, in the 60s and 80s, people trusted the elections. Though there was known bootcaster and such other problems. Whereas today we have mistrust with EVMs and other things. So what is this? What's the reason?
You know, I don't think that personally, this is something that we had a lot of debate in the Citizens Commission of Election. I personally don't think there's any reason to trust a paper-based election. There's no way to establish correctness of a paper-based voting system. And I disagree that this was trusted. I remember my father will always complain. You know, I think that people like me who are brought up in Bengal, booth capturing is an art there.
Yes.
You know, so people who did not support CPM complained for the last 40 years that they captured booths and manipulated elections. So I don't think that at least people in Bengal trusted paper-based election. No one should trust paper-based election. They're a dangerous thing. So elections should be electronic. There's no doubt about it. Just because the paper-based election should not be trusted. You know, the Indian VVPAT system is actually, Indian EVM system is not bad, actually. It is just that the VVPAT audit procedure is completely incorrect. Make that correct, it's a low-hanging fruit, and this becomes a good system. You know, that's the recommendation of the Citizens Commission of Election.
Okay. There's a question addressed to both you and Professor Sharma by Sankarshan. What do you think would be able to convey these concerns that you've articulated in a manner that the institution can take note of?
You know, okay, so I don't have any official contact with the Election Commission of India. Clearly, they don't officially listen.
Not just the Election Commission, but the entire apparatus that is concerned with this.
Being a part author of the report, have spent some time on its understandability. You know, even within the Election Commission of India, I don't think that there is any problem with understandability. They completely understand what we are trying to say. Whether they want to act is a different matter altogether, or whether they want to acknowledge is a different matter altogether. So I think by and large, people who have read the report, this is not that difficult to understand. This is sort of straightforward, that if you are having a paper and an electronic and they're not in one-to-one correspondence, that you need to define which one is the vote. It's a simple English statement, right? So which one should you count? If paper is the vote, then why are you counting the electronic? And if electronic is the vote, then how is the paper auditing the electronic? At least these processes should be made clear. And
perhaps what Mr. Sankarshan is trying to do is to make the system listen,
making the system listen is something that. I tried to leave it to Mr. Devasayam and Justice Madan Lokur.
Perhaps okay. Release white papers and hope that, release as many white papers as possible, keep the discussion in active memory and hope that, enough people, a credible number of people would take it up and force the system to acknowledge.
Okay, thank you. Thanks a lot. There are other comments and questions, but I don't think we have the time. We are already at 5:40. We missed one.